are all related. Here we are all related. We're related to the trees, we're related to the water, we're related to the earth. We are of the earth. So yes, she is our mother, Unchimaka. Unchimaka, our mother. And I'm going to introduce myself as Pujuta Yuhamani Wia. And actually, he gave me that name. And so that's kind of who I am. But I got involved in this like 40 years ago. I ended up at where the Sand Creek Massacre was. And that was my start to walk across the country with the longest walk. And so I got introduced to AIM. But really, I had a very Anglo perspective. I wasn't on the inner circle. I wasn't raised on a reservation. I was raised in Western America, I mean, like standard America, you know? I didn't know anything about Indians. I didn't recognize that I was indigenous. Okay, we got to start that right now. Okay, so we'll do that. Yes. Okay. Okay. All right. Okay. Okay. All right.
We need to start with a prayer.
Okay, you're absolutely right. Okay. So I'm going to introduce Long Soldier, who is a full-blood Lakota elder from Pine Ridge Reservation. And he lives over in Buena Vista. He runs lodges. He pours water. So he's a spiritual elder, and he would like to start all of these happenings, all these ceremonies, always start with prayer and ceremony. And the chinupa, the sacred pipe on this movement, is really leading the way. It's in the forefront. It goes before all else. So prayer, Long Soldier.
Okahe.
He puts me in a place
on the table. Means hello. Now, Petu Washte, good day. Good to see all of you, especially the little ones running around here, you know. They're very sacred. Children are very sacred. I like to. I had a little little baby that was born in the sacred waters. 4 days later, she was in the sweat lodge. The little baby, 4 days old. And she made it all four rounds, you know. So it was good to have a little baby. Because Miniwichoni, that little baby, because of the sacred waters, you know, she was inside her mother's womb, you know. And her mother nourished her with the sacred water so that she may live. And when I pour water, I say, Mitakwayashi, Miniwichoni. Thank you, my relatives, that you all may live. You know, that's what Miniwichoni. Miniwichoni means that people would live, you know. So anyway, I just like to open this up with a prayer. Bless everybody, especially the little ones, you know. I think I did that already by smudging you guys, you know. And it's good to, you know, open these things up with a good prayer, you know. Anytime, any kind of function like this, especially spiritual gathering, you know, it's good to open it with a prayer before we continue. So for Gashala, grandfather, you know, well, he's probably here with us today in the spirit, you know. So I want to say a prayer for all of you, especially the children, you know. Wazia takia hetki ke hampa paoja teki tukashua kantuka tagwashu kaki pana le wigle ja wasitu ki hyö ke siglen anasla anatte egle otta tukashua wachi kapa tukashua on sulla kontai sulla uchoku je shikitu kanu pana 이거 비행기 아마 처음에 낚여 먹는 거라. 일단 속담 시대 맛있게 먹고. 어떻게 할 수 있더라. 어떻게 할 수 있더라. 아니. Oh, I at this time, I want to honor one of my ancestors, the most powerful medicine man back in the 1800s during the Crazy Horse days. Today, I want to honor Sitting Bull and Crazy Horse. As they say, Crazy Horse is the spirit of the Lakota Nation, and Sitting Bull is the voice of the Lakota Nation. So today, bring me my drum, please. I want to honor these two warriors. Oh, yeah. Gosh, well, something for you to stand here with me.
Good.
understanding wrong. I appreciate you being here, all of you. And in that song, it's claiming your health already. It is asking for the health of the people, both spiritual, mental, and physical. So, you know, I want everyone to go away nourished from this and uplifted from this, and knowing that the Indigenous nations need your help, and we want your help. You know, nobody is going to push you away. Nobody is going to, you know, guilt trip anyone. It's like we need to be united. We need to join together on one effort, spearheaded. Maybe it is being spearheaded primarily because there is a land base at argument here. And you know, it's a treaty right issue. If any of you ever looked at the 1852 treaty, the land that was given to the Lakota people, it included Nebraska, included all of South Dakota, part of North Dakota, way out into Iowa. It was a huge, huge territory. It included all of the Black Hills. And then what happened was the Holy Road came through. I don't remember what the American name of it is, but it was just a little pathway, a roadway for for the pioneers to come through. They were to stay on that road, right? They were given access because there was a gold rush in California. And because of that road, everything was lost. You know, so what's happening now with the pipeline is it was moved from Bismarck because the people in Bismarck didn't want their water polluted. They said, no, we can't have it here. And so they moved it to the reservation. And it's treaty land, it's treaty property. But that is no longer recognized. So, you know, all we want, when the Native people lose their rights, believe me, you folks are gonna lose your rights too. So it's an issue, it's a human issue. It's not anymore a Native issue. It's all of our issue, you know? So, yeah, I'm here to say I'm grateful for the people that are standing up and allying with Native people. And so I'm just coming from a grateful heart and saying thank you. Wopila. Lila Wopila. Palami Yelo. You know, I'm so grateful for the people that are standing in front of me, for the people that are standing and taking part in this and saying no more, you know? When has corporate grabbed enough? I mean, it's like, stop already. You know, when do the people get fed? When do the people get nourished? When do we take care of the rights of the people? You know, I would like us to just take maybe a minute worth of time and close our eyes, and each one of you put into a visualization how you want to see the world change. What is it that we need to see in the world to make this happen? You know, what is important to each one of us? To me, this is a nation of nation. When it was colonized, this was, you know, there were natural borders, natural, you know, rivers and mountains made the natural, God made the borders. And so what we have here is multicultural. Now we have world cultures. You know, here in this Turtle Island, we have nation of nations. We have the Dene, we have the Lakota, we have all the Eastern people, we have all the California people. We were a nation of nation, and everyone had their own language, they had their own customs, they had their own interpretation of life. Now we have multi-world cultures. We have to bring all these world cultures together in expression of unity. You know, there is no reason why we have to be whitewashed into one way of looking. You know, we need to have expressions of Lakota. All these nations, these small little Native nations, are losing their culture. They're losing their languages. This has been my passion. 40 years ago, I walked across the country with the longest walk. My passion was, you know, the babies that are being put into foster homes, the languages that are being lost, you know. But now all of a sudden it's being spearheaded by this very important issue of water, you know. So I'm going to give you part of my vision, and then you create the rest of your vision. What else do we need to put down on this map of how we want to change our country? You know, I want to see multicultures. I want to see the indigenous people, you know, honored and respected, and their cultures and their languages yes. brought back into existence from almost extinction.
Yes.
And I want to see the alternative therapies. I want to see the holistic health care. I want to see good health for all people. You know, we can't have good health if we have poisoned water. So we have to start with the earth first, clean earth. I want to see certain companies, I'm not going to name any corporations. We'll just call it the Marauding Bear. We'll call it the enemy.
Black Snake.
The Black Snake, there you go, thank you. The Black Snake. The Black Snake that is consuming and over-consuming and eating up and taking without permission. You know, it's always been the native way. You take an herb, you give a little tobacco. You take something, you give back. You always ask permission. You know, the native, and I hate to reveal this because I'm not putting any of you in this category because you're here. You're supporting us. But the word for the white Anglo society for the native people has always been Wasichus. The Wasichus are coming. The Wasichus. And what that means is the takers without permission. They take without asking. They just take and take and gobble up. You know, the early on native people on the East Coast said, yes, come in, we'll feed you, we'll make you happy. Yeah, take, but they didn't expect that they were gonna log the whole landscape. They didn't understand that they were gonna take all the furs, you know? And the taking has continued. And the taking has got to stop from that Black Snake. And we have to become the important element. The government needs to take care of its people. We should be the most important thing here. And so that's my cry. That's what I want to see. I see a nation of nations, of cultures upon cultures, whether they're Black cultures, Jamaican cultures, Native cultures, Irish cultures, but communities of cultures. That's part of my vision. My other part of my vision is holistic health, holistic healing, healing from the earth, making wellness a priority, clean earth, clean water. You know, we don't need to sustain these corporate entities anymore. So let's take 2 minutes and visualize and put it out there. How do we want to see our country expand and grow, and where do we want to take it? We're responsible for it. So close your eyes, take in a good deep breath, inhaling in through your nose, exhaling out your mouth, and throw those thoughts out into the universe. The beauty, the green earth, the clean air. Feel it, smell it, touch it, see it. And then let's all work for it. Let's put it down. Where do we want to go? Let's work all of our organizations together. Let's do networking. And understand that the Native people need your help They need allies. And, you know, one of the things that I've learned from ceremony, every time I go to ceremony, the theme always seems to be forgive the unforgivable. That's what Native people are being instructed to do. When we go to dances, when we go to ceremony, when we do our work in our gatherings, forgive the unforgivable. So that's where my Shantae, where my heart center is working towards. We have to just let go. You know, I think there are some righteous things that need to be done to heal the past. We need to bring out history. We need to understand what has happened. But we don't have to hold any person, no one has to hold on to that guilt anymore. It wasn't your people, it wasn't, you know, it wasn't anyone that we can touch. It's already been done. But we mustn't do anymore, you know. We need to take care of all our nations, the people. Ahom, Takiasin, all my relations.
Okay. You want to introduce Carrie? Carrie. Okay. Carrie is bringing the next message. Sorry. You're welcome. Greetings, my relatives. My name is Carrie Shelton. I'm a Colorado native. I grew up down on the Front Range. I've lived up here in Vail for 2 years. I'm an enrolled member of the Oglala Lakota tribe. My family comes from Pine Ridge Reservation up in South Dakota. I've been following Native American issues for the vast majority of my adult life. Unfortunately, my family is a product of the boarding school system, which many Anglo people are not aware of, but it is when Native children were forcefully removed from their homes, their hair cut off and beaten if they spoke their native languages. So I have done a lot of work these past years of my adult life trying to reconnect to my culture and my heritage and my spirituality. And back in August, I've been following the Standing Rock Pipeline fight since about early summer last year. And something in August, very, very deep and heartfelt and very, very spiritual, was calling me to go there. And I knew that I had to find a way to get there. It didn't matter how it happened, but I had to go there. So finally at the end of August, I was able to take off some time and I packed up my car full of donations from Four Winds down in Denver and headed north to North Dakota. I'm grateful I was able to break the trip up and stay with family in South Dakota because it's a very, very long drive. But I just wanted to share some of my experience with you. I was there the first day that the violence started. Every single morning at the camp, the women open up by going down to the river and doing a water ceremony, a water prayer. And what had happened when we got back is we had heard there were some violent actions that were occurring up at the pipeline, up at the front lines, is what you may have heard it referred to as. So immediately I got in my car with some new friends that I had made there and drove up to the front lines only to find people walking back, maced, with dog bites, including children and women and elders, and that just lit the fire within me even more. But what I can definitely share with you is from the very first moment that I pulled into this camp, Ochetishakuin, the Seven Council Fires, I have never in my life, there's not even words that can describe the energy and the spirituality that you feel there. I've never felt so much love, so much compassion, so much unity for every single person that was there. And there was natives from all nations, from all countries when I was there. I even met some indigenous people from Ecuador. There were indigenous people from Hawaii, there was people from all over, white people, everybody. But everybody was so welcome and so loving, and it was such an amazing feeling of community that's what I strive for out here in the real world.
Yes.
This is what we need to carry on with this movement, is this feeling of unity and community and fighting for what is ours. And regardless of what nation you come from or what color your skin is or where your background is from, every single person on this planet deserves clean drinking water. Our children deserve clean drinking water. Our children's children deserve clean drinking water. And the next 7 generations to come deserve clean drinking water. Uchimakagra, Mother Earth, she is our original mother. We have to start taking care of her, because if we don't, we're not going to be here anymore. If you think of Uchimakagra much like ourselves, the water is her veins. That's what gives her life. That's what gives us life. We're carried in the womb for 9 months. The womb is water. Our bodies are 80% water, much like the earth is 85% water. So we have to continue this fight. Niwichoni, water is life. This phrase means everything. And it doesn't mean everything just to the Lakota people. It means everything to every single human and every single living creature on this planet. Without water, these dogs running around here wouldn't be here. That beautiful red-tailed hawk that was flying around blessing us earlier wouldn't be here. The fish, these beautiful mountains that are covered in snow. So I'm very, very grateful to see this many people up here. I've been going to a lot of the actions down in Denver, and Robert and I did a little small divest at the Wells Fargo Bank here in Avon, but I am just so honored to see every single one of you here, and just know that from this day forward, you are all considered my relatives. We're all brothers and sisters, because we're all in this together, and we're all here to fight for Uchimaka and our water. All
absolutely.
Right, so thank you for coming. Unlike the previous speakers, I am a humble white woman, and I live in Eagle, Colorado. And I wanted to just bring to you some perspective about what it was like at Standing Rock, because it blew my mind and reminded me of why I exist on this planet. It's probably the most moving time of my life. First of all, I was headed towards the camp. First of all, I want to say thank you to Shannon and the folks who put this on. Thank you so much. And also, this is the first chance I've had. I got the wake up call in the middle of the night, sat up in bed, hi Dagmar, and said, I got to go to Standing Rock. And I put out a press release the next day. And within a week, I had 2 pickup loads packed full of ski clothes and warm clothes and heaters and food, amazing food. The generosity of this valley. Thank you, thank you, thank you all. Thank you. Woo! And I got to, and I'll tell you a little story in a minute about how I got to put that right into the hands of the people who needed it most the day that I arrived. So when we arrived to the Ocheche Sakoin camp, there are 7 tenets of that camp, because it's a spiritual camp. Prayer, respect, compassion, honesty, generosity, humility, and wisdom. Those were the 7 pillars of the camp that we entered. So when Carrie says there was nothing like it, the words can't describe it. If those are the foundations of this place where we were, you can imagine what was going on in between, and the weaving of all the energy, and every prayer had those 7 tenets involved in it. So when we got there, and Tara, I wanted to thank you too publicly for all that you put into the trip to Standing Rock and all the signs that you made, the beautiful signs that unfortunately got bulldozed at the end. But fortunately, she's an amazing artist. She can do it again. She did today. So arriving at this camp, as Carrie said, you turn into the camp and the energy completely changed. It was very sacred. It was a holy place. Now, around the camp, there were police in full riot gear standing next to their iron and metal-clad vehicles with their guns
trained on us 24/7, flying drones over us 24/7, helicopters, airplanes. And at night, which is when we arrived, they had floodlights lighting up the whole place, which was actually kind of handy because I had to set up my tent. So here you are in this amazing bubble of love and honesty and integrity and hope and prayer and wisdom, humility and generosity, respect. And all the way around us was the exact opposite. Fear and hate and anger and projection. Men dressed in black army uniforms, driving excess military vehicles that have been given to sheriff's departments around the country. So we have so much military-industrial complex buildup. So immediately, the thing about Standing Rock, for me, that was so apparent, was we as human beings have a choice. And we can go down one road that was created and held at the camp, and there's another road that was outside the camp. Those are some of the choices that we have to make. And immediately, after I got my tent set up, Mini Wachoni, you could hear it all just echoing through the camp. This is after dark, it's freezing out, and everyone's up at the ceremonial fire praying and dancing and having a great evening of inspiration. And the reason that they were singing and dancing so hard was because the night before, some of the most beautiful young people in the world there are 20 young boys who had run from the Arizona desert with their Hopi brothers, run 500 miles together for over a month to get to Standing Rock. And they were heralded as heroes. And then there was an action out on the bridge, and they sent them out on the bridge, and they got shot. One of them got shot and lost his teeth with rubber bullets that aren't supposed to be aimed at the head. Another girl got shot in her arm. I'm sure you heard about that. She almost lost her arm. They got shot in the knees. They got shot in the chest. And the way that the camp responded to that was to pray harder and pray for the people who are holding the guns. And that's significant. It's to pray for the people who need the prayers the most, who are holding the most fear, the most hate, the most anger. And we run into them every single day, right here in our own communities. So I want to read you the words of what happened next, which were the words of a Havasupai elder who was speaking in the circle the night I got there. And he said this. I wrote it down as soon as I possibly could. And he said, "Welcome everyone. Welcome to Standing Rock. I'm so glad you're here." He said, "This is a sacred place. It's a portal to what is good. The service of evil is not welcome here. You are creating a sacred place here in Standing Rock where spiritual magic is happening." Spiritual magic. I go, yeah, this is the right place for me. "This camp," he said, "is being watched all over the world as a model of a new way of doing community. I honor you all. You are all sentinels rising to be part of an evolution for mankind. When you return home, be sacred orators and speak with your heart leading you. We must find a new way of talking without angry words so people will understand what needs to happen in caring for our Mother Earth. You must go out and be an orator for her and for this new way of being." And that's why I'm standing here today. And I hope that all of you. So that was the belief, the premise, and the prayer of Standing Rock. And it was powerful. It's still powerful in my life. And what I realized was that was a living ceremony. And that each of us is a living ceremony. We are a walking prayer
And that's magic. That's the spiritual magic. So what we walk as our prayer is the magic that each one of us brings to this planet. And there's no accident that you are all here. You know, we all are here on this planet at this time. We're born for now. I wanted to just say a little bit about water. Just a little bit.
Because it's so precious.
I don't know how many of you know the work of Masaru Emoto. So water, Carrie said 80% of our bodies are water. One of the things I was invited to pray at the ceremonial circle at Standing Rock and help lead the women, because I brought sacred water from 200 wells around the world. I have some here now. This water is infused with that. We'll use it in just a few minutes for our ceremony. And I brought it for the seven nations, and for the ceremonial fire. And they invited me to come and speak about that. And what I was trying to communicate to the Wasichus was that here we talk about praying for water. We can't pray about water as it's something else, because water is a living being. It is mutable. When you pray over water, it changes it. And so this Japanese scientist and spiritualist has created a whole body of work around what water does when it is prayed over. Mind you, water is the sacred element that comes as a solid, as a liquid, and as a vapor, as a gas. It's incredible. So this is what water looks like after it's been prayed over. That's crystalline. It looks like the perfect snowflakes that we're so lucky to have here. When it comes out of the tap, it doesn't look like that. Don't believe me. And there's pictures in here. I'll share this with you. So when we talk about going and praying for water, we're praying for the water that's within us. The two words that he found that water responds to the most are love and gratitude. Love and gratitude. So imagine if every time you took a sip of water, you prayed that water into your body. You would be infusing every cell of your body with love and gratitude. That's spiritual magic. That's what they're talking about. And if everybody did that, that's how we would walk our prayer. So I wanted to bring that up. I'll leave this up here. Woo! And the only thing else I want to say is sort of on locally, did I even introduce myself? Yeah, doesn't matter. I'm Susie, I live in Eagle, that's good. But I've lived here for 37 years. Seen a lot happening. So knowing that we can heal ourselves simply by praying within, then we can heal each other, we can heal the world. There's a lot happening in our country today. We all know it. That's why we're all here. We've been activated. We've heard a call. I just wanted to say a shout out to our brothers and sisters in Washington, D.C., the indigenous people who heard our president say that he hadn't forgotten the call. So they look at us. And now they're hearing, he's hearing them call. So they're there. You know, House Bill 861 was introduced yesterday, which would eliminate the Environmental Protection Agency, the Earth Protection Agency. These are the kinds of things we need to be vigilant about, okay? So now is the time for sacred action, creative solutions, creative dialogue, peaceful dialogue, as that's what we were offered through Standing Rock. Thank you to the Eagle County Action Network. We just sent that sign-up sheet around again. I'm a grassroots organizer for wilderness protection here in this county. Have been for 9 years, and thank you. Yeah, wilderness protection has protected our own wild, right? The same thing. What happened when they build a road through it? Gloria talked about that. There need to be places that have no roads. So I just want to leave you with this. Everybody here has a passion. I've got mine. It's wilderness. It's spirituality. It's spiritual ecology. And you all have yours. So find the one thing that you have time and energy to do and do it well, or the two things, because we kind of have to step up right now. So, and encourage each other, and call on me. I have a sacred sanctuary in Eagle, You're always more than welcome to come and renew and regenerate your spirits, because this is hard work. I know, I've been doing it for the last 30 years. So I offer that, and I offer that when you look back at the end of your life, that you have the opportunity to look at the prayer that you walked your entire life and feel the grace and glory of your own individual, sacred, and magical prayer. I hope you have that.